Hi, we're here today with Maxine Gordon, the author of the brand new biography of Dexter Gordon, Sophisticated Giant. And Maxine, let me say, it is an honor to be here interviewing you today.
Thank you so much.
We've been hearing in the jazz pipeline about your book coming out now for several years. I, for one, have been busting at the seams to get my hands on a copy. It's being hailed everywhere, from the New York Times, newspapers across the country, Downbeat, Jazz Times. It must be a thrill for you.
Well, it's a relief.
A relief?
Yeah, a thrill. I'm very happy with the reviews and the response, and it did take a while to finish. Mm-hmm. As Jimmy, he said, he said, she's the reason I live so long, because I wanted to live long enough to read the book, and mm-hmm. now he's over 90.
So, you know, mm-hmm. the book has done something else good also.
Yeah.
After your husband's death in 1990, and correct me if I'm wrong, in order to write this biography, you earned a bachelor's degree in sociology from the City University of New York. Then you earned a master's degree in African studies from New York University, and you're currently a doctoral candidate in history at NYU. You've been a jazz manager, you've been a road manager, you've raised a wonderful son. Is there anything you can't do?
Oh, that's yes, a lot. There's a lot I can't do.
So when you started your academic career, was it with this book in mind?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
How come?
Yeah. Well, because I had promised Dexter to finish the book he began, and I also promised him to finish college because he had not gone to college, and I had left college, and he thought I regretted it. When actually, I think he regretted not going to college. Mm. But anyway, I promised. And be careful what you promise. I try to keep my promises. So I went back to college to get the BA. And then I started thinking about his biography. And I went to California to begin the research on his family and his father, who was the second black doctor in Los Angeles. So I went to the public library in Los Angeles. I said to the librarian, I need all the books and information you have on the early history of African Americans in Los Angeles. And she said, well, that won't take long. And so at that time, there was a dissertation about the early period and early 20th century, and a very small black population at that time, but there weren't books on it. And I read that, and then I thought, I think I have to go to graduate school to figure out how to do the research.
Yes.
So I did. I contacted Robin Kelly, who wrote the great Monk biography.
Oh, that book's beautiful.
One of the best.
Yes.
And I wrote to him, and he was just starting the Monk book, and he said, you know, I met him, and he helped me get into NYU.
Because to me, that's what gives this book a whole added dimension. True, it is a biography of the great Dexter Gordon, but it's also a biography of the history of African-American musicians and just plain people in the 20th century.
Mm-hmm. Well, that was the idea, to look at the whole culture of the time period and use him as an example of what the life was like for jazz musicians.
Man. Nat Hentoff once told me that his two favorite tenor ballad players were Ben Webster and Dexter Gordon.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh,
I used to write down a lot of the things Nat would tell me. And he told me that he loved Dexter's. This is a quote, big heart and sly wit.
Oh.
I love the story of your husband buying Ben's horn in 1973 after Ben Webster passed away.
Uh-huh.
Is that the horn he played for the rest of his
mm-hmm.
life?
It is. It is. But Nat said that to you. He never wrote that, did he?
No. He said it to me over the phone.
Oh, I wish he'd written. Oh, can I use that?
Sure. Dexter's big heart and sly wit when he plays.
See, that's
when he plays
so good, balance. Isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, the horn, Dexter loved Ben Webster. And when Ben died, they in Copenhagen, it's not the horn he called, he named his favorite horn. It's at Rutgers, like Betty or
something like
some
that.
Name like
yeah.
that. But it was a Selmer he had played. And when Dexter played it, he made a joke saying, well, maybe if I play Ben's horn, I could sound as good as Ben, you know, which he sounded pretty good.
Oh, he sounded.
But that was his horn. That was his horn.
Wow. So the two of them, because Ben Webster was born in 1909 and Dexter was born in 1923, they were from different jazz eras, but they thoroughly respected each other as artists.
Right. No, Dexter idolized all the tenor players who came before him. I mean, he loved Ben, and Ben moved to Copenhagen, and so they would see each other all the time. And, you know.
Dexter intensely disliked the image of the jazz musician as the haunted, doomed figure. Uh-huh. That comes through quite clearly in the book. He felt, and he was correct, that his life had an extremely happy ending.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, he met you, for one.
Well, you know, lucky him.
You played such a huge role in his American return, that fateful phone call to Max Gordon, the owner of the Village Vanguard. Mm-hmm. Would you talk about that?
Sure. I was the road manager for jazz groups and jazz festivals in Europe. And in 1975, the agent, it was Dutch, sent me to meet Dexter in Nancy, France, to take the band, find a way to get, there was a threatened train strike, which is quite common in France. So find a way to get them back to Scandinavia, going through Italy and then Germany. And I had a train book, and I met him then, and we began talking about his return. He wanted to come back, and everybody thought it was a really bad idea. They don't care about bebop, don't come back. The advice from all the musicians in Europe was like, don't even think about it. But he had been thinking about it. He wanted to come back, and I was like, oh, well, of course, I didn't know anything. So I thought, well, that shouldn't be a problem. I'll call Max Gordon. So I waited till it was 4 a.m., and then it was 10 p.m. at the Vanguard, and I called Max. And I said, I just heard Dexter Gordon. He sounds so good. You have to give him a gig. He's like, no, I'm not giving him a gig. He's been gone too long. They forgot him. You know, forget it. No, tell him no. I was like, no, Max, I just told you. I heard him, and I had known Max Gordon since I was 15. So I was like, you have to give him a gig, Max. And then my famous line was, if you don't give him a gig, I'll never speak to you again. And he was like, I don't care if you never speak to me. And he hung up. He hung the phone up, but I called back. And then he said, okay, all right, I'll try it, you know, and then.
Because you being so persistent led to the
return. It's called nagging.
Nagging, but persistence. It led to your husband, his triumphant return at the Village Vanguard, which led to an incredible record contract with Columbia Records. I mean, Dexter returning really became the jazz story of the late 1970s.
Right.
And really, it was due to your persistence.
Well, not. I mean, that might be a little over, you know, more than what really happened. I mean, he was prepared. He had saved money to come back. He could rehearse the band, pay the band. I mean, one of the ideas was that Max wouldn't have to guarantee money to pay the band, that Dexter would pay the band. If it went well, then he would give him more bookings and pay. And then when we proposed that to Max, he said, well, that's not a very good deal. I never heard of a musician paying his own band. But Dexter had, you know, prepared for this. And so it was really his idea, and we worked together on it. So, you know, we don't want to say it wasn't me. You know, I facilitated it, but it was really him. And he was ready.
Did Max Gordon ever apologize to you? Like, why was I so narrow-minded?
No, I guess you never met him.
No, I never met him. Met his wife.
That's much later.
Yeah.
No, he was my son. He was my son's godfather. Mm-hmm. He was great to us, you know. But he, you know, no, apologized never.
Yeah.
No, but I mean, he did say, okay, after, you know, several appearances at the Vanguard, he was says, just get your own person on the door, charge whatever you want, and keep all the money.
Yeah.
And he did a concert in Carnegie Hall with Dexter. Yeah. I mean, you know, he didn't have to apologize, you know.
But in hindsight, it just seems ridiculous that he wouldn't say Dexter.
Well,
Gordon,
he hadn't been
course.
In the country for 14 years.
Yeah.
So, you know, I've had conversations with club owners where I say, you know, this so-and-so has a band, he wants to come in here. And they're like, no.
Yeah.
Nobody will come. People to us would be like, wow, that, you know, I'd go,
yeah,
right?
Of course.
But the club owner was like, you know, they're not a draw.
Yeah. Well, you know, your husband living overseas for so long, mostly in Copenhagen, the idea of Dexter Gordon on a bicycle riding around the city of Copenhagen is just beautiful.
Uh-huh.
Beautiful. But it also sheds a light on the racism that jazz musicians faced in this country. Think of your husband, think of the members of the Duke Ellington Orchestra. Sometimes they had to face racism from, let's say, I don't know, a white cracker in Arkansas who'd never been out of Arkansas, and yet these were worldly artists,
right,
who knew the streets of Paris and they knew the streets of Copenhagen and London.
Uh-huh.
That must have made the racism even more difficult sometimes to take.
More difficult. Did you ever see the photo taken by Herman Leonard of Johnny Hodges in the
guy's pouring him a little bit of his wine.
What's that called? The Brasserie Libre,
yes,
in Paris, where the waiter is pouring the wine.
Yeah.
So when you look at that photo of Johnny Hodges, you know, and think about what he lived through in this country, mm-hmm, and what all Black people were living through,
yeah,
he just looked so totally cool. And, you know, you think about the French waiter pouring the wine,
yeah,
and his horns on the table,
yeah,
right? I have that photo.
Yeah.
And, you know, I often think about that. And Herman, that was the point of the photo.
Yeah.
He said if he was in the States, that white man would not be pouring him a glass of wine.
Right.
And so what Dexter said about that, the man's not white, he's French.
Mm.
He said, we're not in the United States.
Yeah.
He said, you know, they have their own problems and issues, but it's not the same.
Yeah.
So he used to point that out, you know.
Louis Armstrong's first visit to Paris was 1932,
right,
and he was shocked. He was on the Boul'Miche, the Boulevard,
uh-huh,
Saint-Michel, and he was shocked when a 12 or 13-year-old white French girl came up and wrapped her arms around him. Louis, Louis.
Right.
And at first he kind of stiffened, like, am I going to get attacked here? But it was a totally different,
right,
culture.
Or like Nat King Cole, when he first went, maybe 50-something,
mm-hmm,
or maybe even before, to Europe, and he came back. He said, Dexter, they give you flowers.
Wow.
He said, they brought flowers out after the concert. I was like, yeah, you give flowers to a man.
Yeah.
And then I realized, you know, how they were reacting to our music. He was like, get a passport,
yeah,
and go to Europe. It took him a while, but he never forgot that.
Oh, of course not. I mean, here are these great, great, great artists finally being treated like the great artists they were,
mm-hmm,
as well as human beings.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
When Dexter moved back to this country, did he speak often of, like, missing Europe, missing Copenhagen? No.
No, because he went back.
Yeah.
You know, he traveled in Europe, he toured in Europe, and
yeah,
not really.
One of Dexter's favorite novels was J.P. Donlevy's The Ginger Man, a book I also love. The fact that the ultimate hipster was also a mellow bookworm makes me love Dexter even more. There were many layers to your husband, were there not?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Or, you know, what might be our general idea about jazz musicians, you know, reading books or painting. Eddie Gladden painted, Billy Higgins played the guitar. I mean, you know, if we didn't know them, like you know so much about jazz musicians,
yeah,
but people who don't think of them as being, you know, on the bandstand.
Right.
But look at Louis Armstrong as an example, those collages.
Yeah.
No, the man was a great visual artist. His letters are, you know.
What a voice as a writer.
Right?
Yep.
He was hilariously funny,
yeah,
you know. He invented jazz singing. I mean, you know, this is the model that he presents is, you know.
Yeah. Could I read a paragraph from your book to you?
Please do.
This is a paragraph that just speaks to me. I just love it. It takes place in my favorite city, Paris. When the long night finally ended and the sky was beginning to lighten, Dexter Bruce, that would be Bruce Lundvall,
uh-huh,
Blue Note Records at the time, Columbia Records, excuse me, and I walked in the middle of the Rue des Lombards toward the Boulevard de Sébastopol. Forgive my pronunciation.
Pretty good.
Dexter stopped, looked around, and said, quote, I'm very glad that you are both here because I had the distinct feeling that I was dreaming that I was in Paris and that I was making a movie about a jazz musician in Paris. End of quote. He smiled that huge smile of his, turned to me and said, "Don't ever forget this moment. It goes in the book. Do you promise?" Well, all these years later, I have kept my promise and it's here in the book. I love that.
Oh, thank you. I love that. I forgot about that. Yeah.
And that was during the making, of course, of Around Midnight film.
Uh-huh. Bruce flew over for the filming. That was, Bruce Langval was his very good friend.
Yeah.
Very good friend.
Now, obviously the word homecoming has a lot to do with Dexter Gordon. It was the name of a Grammy-nominated album. The word homecoming means a great deal to you and to all Dexter Gordon fans. Speaking of homecomings, with Herbie Hancock, Wayne Shorter, Bobby Hutcherson, and Billy Higgins on the set of Round Midnight, that set must have been one hopping place. I mean, what was it like to be with all those musicians? I mean, greeting each other?
Yeah, it was great. That was great. And Dexter had a trailer. You know, it was kind of parked near the set, and they would come in the trailer and hang out and talk. And also in the set for the Blue Note, remember how they're playing live and recording. Mm. So, you know, they began to think that they were going to a gig. You know, they knew they were making a movie, but, you know, they played knowing that they're not going in the studio.
Yeah.
So Bertrand had built a dressing room like would be in a club next to it, but it's not in the movie. You don't see the dressing room in the movie, but he built it and they would hang out in there. It was small and crowded and they'd be in there laughing and talking and like they do. Oh. You know, I mean, they have a way of talking to each other in this kind of code, you know, bebop code. And it was great. It was great.
That's what comes through in your book too. I mean, your husband obviously loved being a jazz musician.
That was it. He loved it.
And every time these great musicians would get together, the laughs, the hugging.
You've seen it,
the
right?
Stories. I have. I uh-huh. have. And just the warmth of these men and women who, on one level, knew they were creating great art, but also lived in a society that treated them like third-class citizens.
Right. But once they go into the club or the dressing room, that what's outside is outside.
Right.
You know, they go in this other environment where, you know, they have their own world. Mm. You know, they have each other and they have their history and, you know, it's a great thing.
A theme of your book, and one which you cover so well, is how the recording industry did take financial advantage of these artists.
Yeah.
How much research went into that?
I'm glad you didn't call it obsession. Right? People have said, oh dear, here she goes.
No,
I mean, call it the political economy of bebop. And I spent many years looking at contracts, learning how to study a contract. Or Farrah Griffin, who wrote the introduction, one time she introduced me at, I think it was at the John Coltrane House. I gave a talk in Philly. And she said about me, I'm going to quote, Maxine Gordon reads a contract the way a Shakespearean scholar reads a sonnet.
There you go.
So I took that as a very great compliment.
Of course.
I would put that on my tombstone if I was having one, which I'm not. But
because you're looking out for your art, for your artist.
No, it wasn't. I didn't learn it like looking out for them. I wanted to understand it. And I also thought that if somebody was going to sign something, they should be able to read it and know what they were signing. So Cedar Walton's a very good example. He used to come to my office. Any contract he was given, he used to put the money down on the desk, and he was like, what does it say? And his mother was an English teacher, and a very smart guy, and he read, and he had, so we'd make a copy, and then, you know, we'd read it out loud, which he hated, and go over every paragraph, what it meant, and he took notes, and he was like, oh, okay, that wasn't too hard to understand. I was like, so you can't do this. You can't sign this. Yeah. I mean, they're going to own it forever. Perpetuity is like the worst word in the vocabulary for a contract, meaning forever and ever and ever. And he said, more than once, he'd say, well, okay, I have to do it. Mm-hmm. But I'm not doing it without knowing what I'm doing. He said, I need the money. The band needs the money. They have bills to pay. You know, I'm not going in blind.
Yep.
But, you know, thank you.
Yeah.
So, you know, I believe, you know, but the contracts have been and continue to be set up not to the advantage of the artist, obviously.
I mean, I've met people in my life who say a lot of times, I can't do that. That's something I can't do. Whether it was reading contracts, being a road manager, diving into an academic career, writing a magnificent book, doesn't seem like you have that fear, huh? But I mean, any challenge that was thrown your way throughout your life, it seems like you just embraced it as a challenge and took it on.
Okay, I never thought of it that way. No. It's like, you know, okay, well, we have to do this, you know.
But what experience had you had in being a jazz road manager before you became
one? Well, none.
Yeah.
But, you know, but I mean, maybe that's like being somebody who says, oh, well, you know, let me see if I can do this. But I also have a thing about asking people who know if they will help. And people were so generous about helping then, you know. And then I try to help.
Yeah.
You know, if I say, you know, if you want me to look at something, I can. A lot of people don't want to show that they don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's something new, but, you know, we would say, you know, I went to Jack Whittemore. He was the biggest and best agent of everybody. I mean, Ahmad Jamal or Blakey, Stan Getz, he was the big agent.
Yeah.
I was like, well, could you teach me how to be an agent? He was like, yeah, come over.
Yeah.
You know, so, and then for going on the road as a tour road manager, that I had to learn on the road.
Yeah.
But, you know, there are things you have to learn by doing.
True. But you weren't afraid of any challenge.
Maybe I wasn't smart enough to be afraid, but anyway.
You mentioned Art Blakey and the Jazz Messengers. Were they your baptism of live jazz?
Yeah, that's my band. That's Art Blakey's my guy.
Yeah.
You know, we are the Jazz Messengers. He always said that.
Wow.
I say that.
Yeah.
You know, and you know Benny Green?
Of course.
Piano player.
Yeah.
He says it. He's a real Art Blakey guy.
Yeah.
In the philosophy, we call it the philosophy of Art Blakey. The philosophy of Art Blakey is that you can do anything, you can open any door, if you can't go through the door, go through the wall.
Yeah.
You know, there's always a way.
Yeah.
And he always said that. So maybe that's why, you know, I thought I could do things that I hadn't done before.
By Boo. Yeah.
We love him. You know, just the way he played was the way he was.
Oh.
Right?
Oh, volcanic.
Right?
Yeah.
Volcanic. And then, you know, it's from Pittsburgh, and I go into Pittsburgh in February, but I also have done a lot of research in Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
You know, that place. I mean,
Billy Strayhorn.
Oh,
yeah.
Mary Lou, yes. Maxine Sullivan, you know, Earl Hines,
you know,
Billy Eckstein. You know, that's unbelievable, right?
Now, your son, Woody Shaw III,
right.
He's working right now with the Mary Lou Williams Foundation, is it?
He's the executive director.
Wow. What kind of work is the foundation doing?
Well, you know, they represent her compositions, and, you know, she has a mass, orchestral pieces. I mean, Mary Lou was so prolific. But plus, he's doing work so that she'll be remembered for her contribution, because really in the beginning of bebop, those guys were in her house learning how to play.
Yeah.
Because when I did my research for my dissertation, I found these Charlie Christian tunes, and the chord changes were written in green. And when I saw that, I asked Father O'Brien. He said Mary Lou wrote the chord changes because she used green ink so that they would know it was her.
Yeah.
And they did that after, in the late 30s, after a gig at Minton's. So she's like working on the early development of bebop with these guys.
Because and she was she a mentor to Monk, too,
wasn't exactly.
she? Yeah,
exactly. And Bud Powell.
Wow.
Right.
Wow.
No, so he wants to work on her music, of course, performance, yeah, and all the rights that she deserves and the money part, but really about presenting her the way she should be presented.
He's quite the writer, too, your son.
Very
his,
good,
his
isn't
afterword
he?
In that
you like
was
it?
Beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I loved in the book, too? Because I was listening recently to a Dizzy Gillespie big band recording from South America, 1956.
Uh-huh.
Melba Liston.
Yeah.
And her friendship with Dexter.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it was almost beyond words, wasn't it?
Right.
The way they communicated with each other.
So true.
And they knew each other from a very young age.
Yeah, I think Dexter was 13, Melba was 10 or something, a junior high or,
yeah,
or middle school or something in L.A.
But what an
array. But she was so much more advanced musically than any of them.
Right.
Uh-huh.
I mean, what an arranger, what
so
a
great,
trombone
right?
player. And
uh-huh.
That's a woman I really would have loved to have heard live. I never
right.
got a chance to.
Right, she was great.
Now, speaking of ladies, your next book,
uh-huh,
Thelma Middleton,
uh-huh,
Shirley Scott,
uh-huh,
is it Melba?
Yes, Melba, Maxine Sullivan.
And Maxine Sullivan. Tell us a little bit about your next book.
Well, I want to write about these four women who are overlooked, you know, basically overlooked, except for people who, you know, really focus on that area. Because, do you remember a book called Four Lives in the Bebop
yes.
Business by A.B. Spellman?
I do.
I love that book.
Me too.
I always remember that book, but I thought, well, couldn't you add one woman in there, you know, the four lives? But he didn't, but I'm going to have four women.
Beautiful.
You know, based on that, the way he did it, and then maybe in each chapter three stories about their lives. Because when I was doing the research for the section on Louis Armstrong, I saw a photo of Dexter in 1944, and it had a woman standing at the end of the band, you know, of the band.
Yeah.
And I said to Ricky Riccardi, you know, the Louis Armstrong
Ricky.
Genius,
yeah,
well, who's that? And he gave me that look, you know, the jazz look like,
come on.
It's Velma,
yeah,
you know, and I didn't know.
Yeah.
I didn't know that period since I'm kind of was in the bebop.
Right.
Box.
Well, your talk on Velma 2 years ago at the Satchmo Summerfest, I'm not just saying this because I'm sitting across from you.
Oh, sure you are.
I'm not. That was a highlight of the talks for me.
Oh, thank
and we're
you.
Very much looking forward to that book, too.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Maxine
Thanks,
Gordon.
Mick.
Your book is a masterpiece, and I'm not using hyperbole.
Thank you, honey.
Thank you very, very
okay,
much.
Okay, thank you.